So one of the most important uses of renormalization theory, at least in theoretical physics, is associated with the theory of quantum electrodynamics. In fact, the person, or the two people, who first told us how to use renormalization theory to understand the quantum theory of electromagnetism, how photons and electrons could interact with each other in cases where, for example, electrons could interact not just with other photons, but with electron-positron pairs that sort of sprung out of a vacuum. The people who first helped us understand that were Murray Gell-Mann, our very own from Santa Fe Institute, and Frank Lowe, who in a paper in the 1950s talked about quantum electrodynamics at short distances. And one of the things they figured out was how to describe the following phenomenon. So you have some electron, and I'll color the electron blue there. You have some electron in your space, and when you ask what kind of effect does that electron have at a distant point, one of the things that you have to take into account, at least in quantum electrodynamics, is that even though this vacuum appears to be empty, even though you've sort of stipulated that there's nothing between you and the electron, it so turns out, in fact, that that field of the electron can actually sort of tear positron, positively charged anti-electrons, positrons, and electrons out of the vacuum itself. So bizarrely enough, right, you get these, even though you think the vacuum is empty, quantum mechanically, it's not. And so you have this amazing phenomenon where these, what are called literally virtual pairs, so you can't actually touch them directly. You can't sort of nip in and pull one out. Well, maybe you can if you're fast enough, right? But in some sense, you haven't put these in by hand, and yet they exist. And what that means, in fact, is that the influence of the electron on that distant point is modified and modulated by all of the stuff that's happening in between. The closer and closer you get to the electron, the less and less those effects conspire to change the underlying theory. But what Gell-Mann and Lowe noticed, in fact, everybody was dealing with this problem, was that the closer you got to the electron, the more you sort of dove into this virtual cloud, the stronger and stronger the effects of the electron itself got. And in fact, what happened at very small distances was that the charge of the electron, the effect it had on you, seemed to diverge and become infinite. So that was a huge problem. No one knew how to solve it, right? And in the end, they invented a series of mathematical tools to help people understand how they could solve it. Now, we don't have time to teach you quantum field theory, let alone the renormalization problem, but beautifully enough, we do have a sort of toy model for how this renormalization process works, for the kinds of physics that Gell-Mann and Lowe were doing, and then later, of course, Feynman and a number of other people who followed in their footsteps. And in fact, what we can do is talk not about quantum fluctuations, which are much harder, right? You gotta talk about virtual worlds and all sorts of philosophically compelling but mathematically difficult things. In fact, it turns out that we can tell a good part of this story not in terms of quantum fluctuations, but in terms of sort of classical thermal fluctuations. And in fact, you've already seen in the example of thermal fluctuations when we introduced the icing model. As you remember, we had this coupling parameter, beta, in the icing model. The stronger the coupling was, the more and more the particles like to align with each other. They wanted their internal states to be the same, right? So now, as you decrease the coupling parameter, or in physics language, as you increase the temperature, particles had a greater and greater tolerance for, instead of both being in the same state like this, for sometimes them to flip, right? And you can think of this as a thermal fluctuation. The minimum energy configuration is like this, right? All the particles all pointing up, or all the particles all pointing down. But instead, if the temperature is high enough, you sometimes get these fluctuations, and if the temperature is high enough in the icing model, those fluctuations can actually propagate arbitrarily far. You go through the critical point, and then in fact you totally decouple, and now they seem totally uncorrelated, okay? So what we're gonna do now is tell a story about the behavior of electrodynamics in the presence of thermal fluctuations, not in the presence of these sort of strange virtual particles, but in something that you interact with every day of your life, although hopefully only in an intermediate fashion, because otherwise you would die, and that is the plasma. So what is a plasma? A plasma is just a gas where the positive nuclei have been separated from the negatively charged electrons. A plasma, I certainly encountered these when I was a graduate student in astrophysics. In fact, for example, in the case of the solar wind, you have this gas that's coming off the sun. It's being bombarded by photons from the sun. It's extremely hot. And occasionally, those photons will rip the electron off an atom, and that electron will fly off. But the gas is so diffuse, in fact, that it can never really find its old nuclei again, right? It can never sort of recondense back together. And so the solar wind is an example of a very diffuse plasma. On Earth, we build plasmas all the time. One of the most extreme cases that we do is when we try to build a tokamak. In other words, when we try to get nuclear fusion going. In order to do that, we'll take something like helium or hydrogen, we'll heat it up as hot as we can, separate out the positively charged nuclei from the electrons, and then we'll do some magic and try to get these guys to stick together, right? Okay, but that's a whole other story, and it's always 20 years in the future, that solution. But plasmas exist in all sorts of places in the real world, including, for example, in the fluorescent lights. So in that tube, you have a very rarefied gas, and what happens is the electric field produced on either end of that tube enables the gas to separate out into its constituent positively and negatively charged particles, okay? So what we're going to do, our plasma is going to be sort of our virtual background of particles that occurred in quantum electrodynamics, except now it's much easier. We don't have to think about like how these could be sort of ripped apart from nothing. Instead, what we're going to assume is that we have some gas, let's say in a box, and the gas is separated into its positive and negatively charged parts.